Rob Dorster was joined by Gary Parrish of CBS Sports on Monday afternoon to work through the latest happenings in the college basketball world, from the Knight Commission to the Commission on College Basketball to the recruitment of the likes of Romeo Langford and James Wiseman. It is a good conversation, one that spends quite a bit of time discussing Kylia Carter and the things that she had to say today in front of the Knight Commission, as well as taking a deep dive into babies on airplanes, the horrors of traveling with children, and when it is okay to yell at old ladies. Open, was Rob justified in yelling at an old woman after his travel nightmare? 1805, the Commission on College Basketball, the Knight Commission, and Kylia Carter. How it all fits together, and why nothing is being done to fix the sport just yet. 43-55, James Wiseman's recruitment, Romeo Langford's commitment, and what they have in common. When the Commission on College Basketball was formed to analyze the problems of the sport that were brought to light by an FBI investigation into corruption, there weren't many in or around the sport that truly believed it would be a game-changing exercise. The expectation, mostly, was that there would be some hand-wringing, some suggestions that tackle little of the fundamental problems and not a whole lot more. That's pretty much what the Commission delivered. Now, we've come to find out why, or at least one reason, there was not a closer and more honest look at a solution that could actually make a positive difference in the sport, both for players and those who want the game to push the illicit aspects further to the fringes. The reason, of course, was not to upset the money-making apple cart. Certainly kids should be able to benefit from their name of image and likeness, NBA Hall of Famer and Rice Commission member David Robinson said Monday. The commission, as Robinson indicates, didn't want to address it because of pending litigation. Hold up. Last I checked, there was pending litigation for the 9 people, including 4 assistant coaches, who are facing charges stemming from the FBI's investigation. That didn't stop Rice and Co. from addressing shoe company involvement, the structure of grassroots hoops, and punishment for coaches who run afoul of the rules. But pending litigation that might strip NCAA member institutions from their ability to solely profit from their athletes' name and likeness, that's the bridge too far, come on. This is, again, the crux of the problem facing the NCAA. President Mark Emmert and whoever succeeds him and whoever succeeds that person and on to infinity can assemble as many committees, commissions and panels as they want, but if the fundamental issue, people want to pay good college basketball players good money, isn't addressed, what are we even doing here passing off the responsibility because of pending litigation rings so hollow and as an abdication of responsibility? It is maddening. But of course players should be able to profit off themselves, but we, the group of people tasked with helping clean up the game, didn't want to wade into those waters. Instead, well, just say the NCAA, which I may remind you is the governing body overseeing the sport that has garnered federal law enforcement involvement, should take over summer basketball. Sound good, cool. The Rice Commission, wasn't serious about actually fixing the problems of college basketball if it purposely, willingly and strategically avoided the problem that is explicitly created by the system and its rules. All of this is a waste of time. The Knight Commission on Intercollegiate Athletics supports recent reform proposals to the NCAA amid a federal corruption investigation into college basketball, but wants the NCAA to do more. The commission suggests changing the NCAA's governance structure and additional financial regulations regarding coaches or school employees receiving outside income from apparel companies. The Knight Commission issued its proposals during its spring meeting Monday in Washington, roughly 2 weeks after the committee led by former U.S. Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice issued recommendations to overhaul the NCAA. It's an open question if the NCAA can restore public confidence in its ability to be stewards of big-money college sports, said Arn Duncan, the commission co-chairman and a former U.S. Secretary of Education. To do so, it will need to embrace far more sweeping and deep-seated reform than ever before. The Rice Committee's recommendations included ending the one-and-done NBA rule, overhauling the enforcement process to handle complex cases of potential rules violations, and creating a certification system to regulate agent conduct. Rice's Commission on College Basketball formed in October, a few weeks after federal prosecutors announced they had charged 10 men, including assistant coaches at Arizona, Auburn, USC and Oklahoma State, along with a top Adidas executive, in a fraud and bribery. The case involves hundreds of thousands of dollars in alleged bribes and kickbacks designed to influence recruits on choosing a school, agent or apparel company. It has entangled schools such as Kansas, North Carolina State, Louisville and Miami, among others, though prosecutors withdrew a criminal complaint in February against one of the defendants. Among its proposals, Rice's committee had recommended the NCAA restructure its board of governors, made up of college presidents or chancellors, to add at least 5 outside members to bring more independent voices into leadership. Separately, the Knight Commission wants at least 6 independent members on the 24-person Division I board of directors, also made up of school representatives. It also wants more stringent approvals and disclosures for income from apparel companies. That includes prohibiting athletics employees from having a contract contingent on players using the company's products, a right the commission instead reserved for the schools themselves. The Knight Commission, formed in 1989 to support the educational mission of college sports, also seeks to have public disclosures of the outside income, both for public and private schools, received by university employees from the apparel companies. The commission heard from several people during its Monday meeting, including NCAA Chief Legal Officer Donald Remy, ESPN analyst Jay Beelers, St. Joseph's coach Phil Martelli and Kylia Carter, the mother of Duke One and Dunn forward Wendell Carter Jr. Remy said the NCAA groups are working to have legislation based on the Rice Commission's recommendations ready to present in August and adoption in time for next. There were no stakeholders who should not have been put on alert as the commission report was read, Martelli said. We are not here to rebuild college basketball. We're here to create a new model. And if you're not in, you're out. Beelers, a frequent NCAA critic, said the Rice Commission didn't address the amount of money flowing through the game and a failed concept of amateurism that instead should compensate athletes with more than an education. When I pull back the layers, the problem that I see is not with the student-athlete, Carter said. It's not with the coaches and the institutions of higher learning. But it's with a system, like the only system that I have ever seen where the laborers are the only people that are not being compensated for the work that they do. While those in charge receive mighty compensation. The only two systems where I've known it to be in place is slavery and the prison system. And now I see the NCAA as overseers of a system that is identical to that. With 3 players testing the NBA waters this offseason, Nevada has a little roster uncertainty. The Wolfpack added a player Monday to help mitigate that. Ehab Amin, a 6'4 graduate transfer from Texas A&M Corpus Christi, has signed with coach Eric Musselman's program, the school announced. We are extremely excited about the addition of Ehab to our program, Musselman said in a statement. He was a first-team all-conference player and has shown the ability to score, rebound, and excels at creating extra possessions with loose balls and steals. He is an elite defender and can play multiple positions, anywhere from point guard to the power forward. He plays with such great energy and effort and has a big-time motor. Ehab is also an excellent student with great leadership qualities. I have decided to commit to the University of Nevada. I really felt home around my future teammates and the coaching staff and couldn't find a better coach to play for than Coach Musselman. I'm confident this will be a great year for me and for Nevada. Go Pack Basketball Biceps pick.twitter.com/84rgphe3bz Ehab Amin at Ehab_Amin 4 May 7, 2018 Amin sat out last due to a hip injury, but averaged 16.9 points and 6.6 rebounds per game as a junior in 2016-17. He becomes the second grad transfer for Musselman this offseason as Old Dominion center Trey Porter pledged to the Wolf Pack last month. I really felt at home around my future teammates and the coaching staff, Amin wrote on social media, and couldn't find a better coach to play for than Coach Musselman. I'm confident this will be a great year for me and for Nevada. Nevada will now await the decision of Jordan Caroline, Caleb Martin and Cody Martin, all 3 of whom declared for the NBA draft but have not hired agents. Cody and Caleb Martin both received invitations to next week's NBA draft combine. The Wolfpack are ranked 8th in our preseason top 25. San Diego State landed one of the top players remaining on the transfer market. Malachi Flynn, a 6'1 transfer from Washington State, pledged Monday to the Aztecs, giving coach Brian Dutcher a high-scoring guard with 2 years of eligibility remaining. After much prayer and thoughtful consideration, I am blessed and thankful to announce that I will be transferring to San Diego State University to further my education and basketball career, Flynn wrote on social media. I want to thank every school and coach that recruited and showed interest in me during this process, and each of you that supported me during this transition as well. I'm excited for this next chapter and look forward to being a part of the Aztec family. Flynn averaged 15.8 points while shooting 41.3% from the floor and 33.8% from three-point range. He also posted 4.3 assists and 3.4 rebounds per game for the Cougars. Flynn will have to sit out the 2018-19 under NCAA transfer rules, but then will have 2 years left to compete. He picked the Aztecs over the likes of Creighton, Baylor and Gonzaga. Kylia Carter knows all too well about the perils of the NCAA. She herself is a former student athlete, having been a scholarship basketball player at Ole Miss in the 1980s. Wendell Carter Sr., her husband, played at Delta State and professionally in the Dominican Republic. Her son, Wendell Carter Jr., was a top 5 prospect that played at Duke. The family, in the course of Jr.'s recruitment, wound up reportedly sharing a meal with Christian Dawkins, which became public knowledge when Yahoo Sports was able to get their hands on the expense reports that Dawkins filed with the agent, Andy Miller, he worked for. Suffice to say, she knows a thing or two about the realities of big-time college basketball. She's also woke. She understands the value of an education, she pushed her son to attend Harvard for his one and done, and is aware of the fact that the life her and her family led is different than the life that is led by most black families in America. That is why she was such an intriguing choice to speak at the Knight Commission, an independent group that promotes reform to strengthen the educational mission of college sports. Not only is she an outspoken advocate for change regarding the NCAA's arcane amateurism bylaws, but she does it while trumpeting the value of an education. And the major point that Kylia makes during her 12-minute speech on Monday is simple: there is no actual value to the education that the NCAA members provide to players like her son, because athletes like Wendell Carter Jr. are not being recruited because of the value they bring to the academic community on campus, they are being recruited because they excel in a sport that provides massive financial windfalls for the school. She also makes it clear that she understands the value of a scholarship. If she didn't, she would not have pushed her son to play at Harvard. But what value are athletes going to get out of 2 semesters worth of introductory courses, particularly when they are basketball players that spend half of each semester dealing with travel schedules that force them to play midweek games away from home? I've spent enough time ranting about amateurism and the Commission on College Basketball recently, and if that is the kind of thing you are interested in, read this and this. I won't bore you with those arguments today. What I will say, however, is that Kylia Carter knows how this system works from just about every angle. When she talks, you should at the very least listen to what she says and take it to heart. And what she said Monday was quite powerful. The video is above. Below is a transcription of the most important part of it all. As we grew in this business and we pulled back all the layers, and I began to see what I was actually looking at. To be honest with you, it's nauseating. To have the opportunity to say this and not say it, I'll feel like I felt when I was a student athlete at Mississippi and my friends were in classrooms being called horrific names, having food and things thrown at them as they were walking past the union. And them saying these things to me and me telling them, surely not. There's no way that's happening. This is a wonderful place. I'm having such a great time. Everything is going so wonderful. What are you talking about? And so I migrated to the people that were having experiences like mine instead of those that were having trouble that looked like me, that were having real struggles. So, I say that to say, I cannot be here now and not say that when I pull back the layers, the problem I see is not with the student's athlete, it's not with the coaches or the institutions of higher learning, but it's with a system like the only system that I have ever seen, where the laborers are the only people that are not being compensated for the work that they do, while those in charge receive mighty compensation. The only 2 systems that I've known that to be in place is slavery and the prison system. And now I see the NCAA, the overseers of a system that is identical for that. So it's very difficult for me to sit here and not say that there is a problem that is sickening. But the problem isn't being directed in the right place. And I think that it should be. And I think that the covers should be pulled back and everyone be able to see the truth and what's happening to the student athlete and their family. Because once these students are recruited to these institutions of higher learning, which are fantastic, I am a proponent of academic excellence, a proponent of education, a proponent of knowledge. I love it. It's beautiful to me. That's why my son had such a hard time selecting between Harvard and Duke, because his mother and father wanted him to go to Harvard because of the experience for a man that looks like him. Though he didn't choose it, I am so ever grateful that he went to Duke. It was a wonderful experience and everything that he needed it to be to get to him to this next level. Still, after the infractions that they accused us of doing, something with one of the people being investigated by the FBI. But I was still flabbergasted at the people that were being indicted. I knew some of those people. I know for a fact that this has been going on since I was being recruited. I'm a female, so I know that the recruitment was vastly for male athletes, and it was corrupt then. I remember kids not being able to pass the ACT test. They called them Prop 48 students. And they would let the Prop 48 students come to school and play, knowing that they couldn't pass the academic portions. But they let them in school anyway. They would tell you it was to afford you this scholarship. No, it's because of the money that you would bring to that institution for playing all those years. Or you being a part of that program. At the end of the day, the talent is being purchased. The talent is being purchased, but the talented are not receiving any of the benefit. The colleges are only recruiting the talented kids for their talent, not because they will excel at their academic institution. So why is that the benefit of them going to that institution? I want them to go, but I want them to go for 2 years. If you're going to make them go and get something from it. Why can't they go to college and get this 2-year certificate in this professional sport that they are pursuing if they are that talented, so that they are aware and educated on the business of the sport that they want to play? There's a model that's similar to this overseas, where they get the kids out of high school. Luka Doncic, a Slovenian playing for Real Madrid that is the potential number one pick in the 2018 NBA draft, has been playing professional for years. There's a program in place to do that for him. Why is there not something to protect these children that look like my son and me? To protect them as they pursue what their talents have afforded them to pursue, and I'm not talking about an agent, I'm talking about a not-for-profit organization to teach them and help them, and to teach them to stay close-knit and do the things so they can remain successful. I'm going to stop because I will continue and go on and on. My mission, my goal and my understanding for being here is to protect and hopefully help everyone to see the need to surround the athlete and protect them and their families moving forward.